Gilded Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Surprising Science of Meetings, How You Can Lead Your Team to Peak Performance, by Dr. Stephen G. Rogelberg, narrated by L.J. Ganser. Preface. Meetings are not in and of themselves problematic. Meetings are essential to teams and organizations. Without meetings, organizational democracy, inclusion, participation, buy-in, communication, attachment, teamwork, coordination, and cohesion would all be compromised. What we need to rid ourselves of are bad meetings, wasted time in meetings, and unnecessary meetings. This book is about solving these problems. Meetings consume massive amounts of individual and organizational time, with a recent estimate suggesting there are 55 million meetings a day in the United States alone. The costs of this meeting time are staggering when weighted with the average salary data of attendees. It is estimated that the annual cost of meetings in the United States is a whopping $1.4 trillion, or 8.2% of the 2014 U.S. GDP. Furthermore, this tremendous time investment yields only modest returns. Too many meetings was the number one time waster at the office, cited by 47% of 3,164 workers in a study conducted by Salary.com, focused on workplace time drains. Translating this into dollars, one reasonable estimate is that over $250 billion a year is wasted by having too many bad meetings. And these estimates do not include the indirect costs of bad meetings. For example, employee frustration and strain. Sadly, most companies and most leaders view poor meetings as inevitable because they don't know of better ways or they try new methods that don't stick, as they really are not founded in any scientific evidence of success. Also, bad meetings beget more bad meetings as dysfunctional practices become normative across the organization. Taken together, poor meetings become accepted as a way of life and a natural cost of doing business, like rain is a way of life in London. But unlike the weather, meetings can indeed be improved. Drawing on over 15 years of original research I have conducted on the topic of meetings with my team, surveying and interviewing thousands of employees from hundreds of organizations, as well as drawing from a large number of evidence-based sources, my goal with this book is to translate the science of meetings to bring direction, guidance, and relief to those leading and participating in meetings. While many people I meet are surprised to hear that there are social and organizational scientists who study meetings, this research has produced large numbers of scientific publications, conference presentations, book chapters, dissertations, and extensive media coverage. And of most relevance here, this science has produced insights and practical applications that can directly benefit executives and organizations by promoting efficiency, productivity, increased innovation and employee engagement, superior decisions, enhanced commitment to initiatives, better communication, and a greater sense of camaraderie across the workforce. I wrote this book for any individual responsible for calling and leading meetings at work. This includes team leaders, supervisors, managers, directors, and senior executives across organizations and industry sectors. It is for learning and development professionals, executive coaches, and other educators who train and advise people on teamwork and leadership. It is for HR leaders and senior organizational leaders working to change the meeting culture at their organization. Each chapter in this book goes into depth on a particular vexing meeting derailer as a way of setting up evidence-based solutions. As a general approach, I bring light to the types of dysfunctions at hand in meetings, and then provide a set of specific best practices and solutions to help you recover wasted time. I make these recommendations on the basis of reasonable extrapolations from the evidence, and also by examining what cutting-edge organizations like Google and Amazon are doing. What counts as a meeting? Meeting sizes and meeting purposes can vary tremendously. In general, the focus here is on the most typical types of meetings found in organizations, They vary in size from 2 to 15 attendees, and generally are ostensibly about coordination, communication, decision-making, and monitoring. I cover everything here, from the weekly meeting, to strategy meetings, to planning meetings, to task force meetings, to troubleshooting meetings, to brainstorming meetings, to debriefing meetings. That said, I can't imagine a meeting type or situation that would not benefit from learning about what works and what doesn't. Try applying what you learn here to a full-day retreat, or to organizational training, or to client meetings, or to your community meeting, religious meeting, or PTA meeting. Every situation involving two or more people coming together for discussion, communication, coordination, or decision-making can benefit from a thoughtful, evidence-based approach, an approach that truly honors the time and commitment of all parties. Bad meetings can drain the life out of individuals and organizations, but meetings done well, leveraging evidence-based solutions, like the ones we'll explore in this book, can be transformative and hugely positive. The cascading positive effects of improving just one meeting each day, across people and across time, yields not only tremendous organizational benefits, from cost savings to better organizational strategy, but also individual feelings of satisfaction, engagement, and accomplishment. At the same time, leaders and future leaders mastering meeting leadership skills are uniquely positioned to elevate their own career progression and personal success as they become highly adept at working with others, building relationships, unleashing others' full potential, and achieving team wins. Conversely, without these meeting leadership skills, one joins the ranks of so many others who bear the responsibility for the meeting problem and are the cause of so much frustration in the workplace. Section 1. Setting the Meeting Stage. Chapter 1. So many meetings and so much frustration. I have way too many meetings. Joe nearly everybody, employee in nearly every company incorporated. Once I tell most anyone that I do research on meetings, I typically hear in response what I call the meetings hell lament. This lament usually includes comments such as 1. All I do is sit in meetings. 2. If you want to know about bad meetings, follow me for a day. 3. We even have meetings on meetings. Or 4. You need to study my organization. It is a case study for meeting dysfunction. Relatedly, popular press headlines abound expressing similar sentiments. Take, for instance, the article in the Harvard Business Review titled, "Stop the Meeting Madness." In fact, out of curiosity, I Googled too many meetings. There were over 200,000 hits. This raises the questions, how many meetings do people attend each day? Has that number increased over time? While the simple answers are a lot and oh yes, let's unpack those answers in a more diligent manner. First, to be able to count something, we have to define it. By defining what a meeting is, we can start tabulating the actual number of meetings that occur across the globe more systematically. With that, a work meeting is defined as a gathering of two or more employees for a purpose related to the functioning of an organization or a group. For example, to direct, to inform, to govern, to regulate. The gathering can occur in a single modality, for example, a video conference, or in a mixed modality format, for example, mostly face-to-face with one participant connected via telephone. Typically, meetings are scheduled in advance, some notice is provided, and are informally or formally facilitated by one of the attendees. Meetings can be extremely brief, 5 minutes, to a full day in length. According to Elise Keith, co-founder of the software firm Lucid Meetings, who extrapolated information from the most commonly referenced meetings databases collected by Verizon, Microsoft, Fuse, and others, every day in the United States, there are roughly 55 million workplace meetings. Yes, 55 55 million meetings a day in the United States alone. 40-plus years ago, in 1976, Anthony Jay reported in the Harvard Business Review that there were approximately 11 million meetings per day in the country. Clearly, a massive increase in meetings has occurred over time. Now let's take a look at how these massive numbers translate into the day-to-day experiences of individuals at work. Elise Keith's analysis, consistent with my research, suggests that non-managers attend 8 meetings per week on average, while managers enjoy 12 meetings per week on average. These numbers would certainly be higher for particular job types, for example, white-collar jobs, and meeting demands increase as we move up the organizational hierarchy, with those in the upper echelons of management spending most of their days booked solid with meetings. As for this level of managers, there is some intriguing work coming out of the Executive Time Use Project. A group of professors from the London School of Economics and Columbia and Harvard universities studying how CEOs spend their time. In one study, looking at 94 CEOs of top Italian firms and 357 corporate leaders in India, they found that 60% of CEOs' working hours and 56% of corporate leaders' working hours were spent in meetings, and these figures did not include conference calls. To help put these numbers in context, I asked a set of executives each to tell me about a typical day in the life as it relates to meetings. I started with two CEOs. The first, a chancellor of a leading state university, reported that in his typical day, he had 7 meetings, totaling nearly 5 hours. The CEO of a large national advocacy nonprofit also provided me with a typical day. The day involved 8 meetings, lasting a total of 6.5 hours. Next, I discussed meeting load with a senior vice president and chief human resources officer at one of the largest global food and beverage companies in the world. The day she shared with me, which she indicated was typical, involved 6.5 hours in meetings, with a number of her meetings on this particular day dedicated to preparing for a future meeting, an annual succession planning meeting with a sector CEO. Why are there so many meetings? Clearly, there is a great deal of meeting activity going on at work, especially for those toward the top of the organization. This again raises the question, why are there so many meetings? Putting aside the fact that some leaders may overuse meetings, given their personal proclivities, for example, an unwillingness to make a decision, a desire to appear active to others, the answer to this question is multifaceted, and in many ways reflects a changing societal and organizational zeitgeist around work. Beliefs around the value and benefits of employee inclusion, of empowerment, of teams, of employee buy-in, and of employee engagement are more prominent than ever as efficient ways to achieve short-term and long-term organizational survival and success. Meetings are a key mechanism to express these values. Relatedly, democratization has penetrated deeply into organizational life, with command and control leadership models becoming less dominant. Instead, organizations have become flatter and less hierarchical. Again, all roads lead to more meetings, the mechanism to bring people together, gain input, promote discussion, promote synergy, provide voice, explain things, coordinate, foster ownership, and learn and grow as a unit. In the Harvard Business Review article mentioned at the start of this chapter, a senior executive from a pharmaceutical company noted, "I believe that our abundance of meetings at our company is the cultural tax we pay for the inclusive learning environment that we want to foster, and I'm okay with that. If the alternative to more meetings is more autocratic decision-making, less input from all levels throughout the organization, and fewer opportunities to ensure alignment and communication by personal interaction, then give me more meetings anytime." While in Chapter 2, I will argue that the elimination of meetings in and of themselves is absolutely a false goal, the goal should actually be to eliminate ineffective and bloated meetings. It is still important to take stock of what meetings are implicitly and explicitly costing an organization, and what the return is on that investment. How much money are we investing in meetings? The most basic way of calculating meeting cost considers time and salaries. For each attendee, calculate the amount of time in the meeting multiplied by his or her hourly salary. Then, add each attendee's sum together. For example, say there is a director-level staff meeting with 7 people that lasts an hour, with an average yearly salary of $120,000 per attendee, approximately $60 an hour. That meeting alone would cost $420. If this staff meeting occurs every week for a year, the total annual cost is about $21,000 for just that one meeting. Or consider a more senior leadership cabinet meeting with 12 attendees, 2 hours in length, and an average attendee salary of $240,000, approximately $120 an hour. Each meeting would cost $2,880. If this happens once every 2 weeks, the overall cost for the year would be approximately $74,880. It is easy to see that as the number of meetings compounds across people, layers of management, and time, the costs become tremendously high. Now let's extrapolate even further by viewing the issue from a corporate perspective. Xerox, for example, estimated the immediate costs of meetings in their 24,000-person manufacturing and development unit. In terms of meeting time and employee pay, costs were estimated at $100.4 million annually. Other studies suggest that 15% of the personnel budget is spent on meeting time. Finally, going to a societal level, Elise Keith's analyses estimate the cost of meetings in the United States at $1.4 trillion spent per year, or 8.2% of the 2014 U.S. GDP. Interestingly, these figures are actually underestimating the costs of meetings. In addition to not using fully loaded salaries, which include employee benefits costs, the estimations ignore the direct costs associated with the meeting space, meeting equipment, and potential travel costs of attendees. Furthermore, and perhaps most importantly, these estimates do not take into consideration indirect costs associated with bad meetings, meetings deemed a poor use of time by attendees. Indirect costs include opportunity costs, time that could be spent elsewhere productively, even if this is just quiet time to explore thoughts and generate new ideas, that is, to just catch one's breath and stop to reflect and think. Then there are the potential psychological costs associated with employees suffering through bad meetings. This includes erosion of employee engagement, employee frustration, the draining of employee spirit, and time spent ruminating and grousing over bad meetings. Finally, there is the concept of meeting recovery syndrome, which refers to the time spent winding down after a frustrating meeting. This recovery process not only affects the frustrated attendee, but also potentially zaps the energy of those around the individual upon hearing the complaints and providing support. When you take into account all the direct costs and potential indirect costs, the investment in meetings is incredibly significant. If you liken a meeting to a type of communication technology, could this actually be one of the largest unidentified line items in an organizational budget? I can say with confidence that there is no single investment of this magnitude that an organization makes that is treated in such a cavalier manner, where so few resources are allocated to assessing, evaluating, and working to improve meetings, both locally and enterprise-wide. What does the science say? Are meetings working? Are they an effective use of time? Scientific reports on meeting effectiveness vary a fair amount. On the one hand, there is extensive evidence that meetings are draining the life out of individuals, teams, and organizations. For example, in 2005, Microsoft surveyed close to 40,000 people about productivity and work-related practices. They found that 69% globally and 71% of workers in the United States indicated that meetings were not productive. Then, a 2012 survey, conducted by Salary.com regarding time wasters at work, revealed that too many meetings was the number one time waster at the office. In fact, 47% of the 3,164 workers reported this answer. Finally, in 2014, Harris Poll conducted a survey for Clarizon, a project management company involving over 2,000 working adults. The focus was on what they referred to as status meetings, which are defined as meetings with updates for team members on completed and in-progress work activities. Nearly 3 of every 5 workers reported that they multitask during status meetings. Almost 50% of respondents indicated that they would rather do any unpleasant activity, for example, go to the Department of Motor Vehicles, than attend a status meeting. Overall, 35% of respondents indicated that status meetings are a waste of time. These data certainly look bleak with regard to meetings. I can also say these data are quite consistent with what I observe when I speak to leaders at training sessions. Namely, often I will do an exercise with attendees, asking them as a group to give me some insight into the quality of their meetings. I tell them, "I want to know what percentage of your meetings are not a good use of time." I then name percentages and ask them to clap if the percentage stated aligns with their experiences. Almost unequivocally, 50 to 70% of meetings are a waste of time receives the most applause, regardless of whether I ask this question of an audience in South America, Asia, Europe, or North America. Now, with all this said, there are some data suggesting the evaluations of meetings are not as depressing. Verizon surveyed over 1,000 heavy meeting-goers. When participants were asked about meeting productivity, the results were more favorable than earlier data shared. 22% indicated their meetings were extremely productive. 44% indicated their meetings were very productive. 27% indicated their meetings were somewhat productive. 6% indicated their meetings were not very productive. 1% indicated their meetings were not at all productive. And in a study I conducted with over 1,000 employees and managers, I asked participants to evaluate the quality of their meetings in general. The results were fairly similar to those of Verizon's study. 17% rated their meetings as very good to excellent. 42% rated their meetings as good. 25% rated their meetings as neither good nor bad. 15% rated their meetings as poor or very poor. So, what is the truth? Taken together, the truth is likely an average of all the data just presented, which would result in a generally negative assessment of meetings, but with a good number of useful meeting experiences thrown in, likely tied to certain leaders who truly are good at running meetings. However, even if you fully identify with the somewhat more positive meeting data presented here, it is still obvious that, 1, there is much room for improvement in meetings, and 2, there is a ton of frustration being expressed. Relatedly, the research on meetings is certainly clear about the existence of a wide range of problems that we must work to overcome. For example, the meeting being dominated by 1 or 2 people. That said, the most important truth is your own local truth. What truly matters most is your organization's return on its meeting investment. To help you identify the truth for your team, your department, and your organization, I have provided here a meeting quality self-assessment. Self-assessment. Are you maximizing your return on investment from your meetings? At the end of the book, a variety of tools are provided to help you better understand your meeting experiences, and most importantly, to improve them. One tool is called the Meeting Quality Assessment, Calculation of a Wasted Meeting Time Index. In this tool, you are asked to indicate the percentage of time that certain negative things happen or are present in your meetings. This assessment covers the following: 1, meeting design; 2. The meeting itself, time dynamics. 3. The meeting itself, interpersonal dynamics. 4. The meeting itself, discussion dynamics. 5. Post-meeting. A scoring metric is then provided. The grand average percent that is calculated represents wasted meeting investment. In other words, this grand average is a wasted time index. Here is a guide to interpret your grand scores based on my work with organizations. If your scores are between 0 and 20% wasted meeting investment, your meetings are really quite productive. While there is room for improvement, your scores are above what is typical. If your scores are between 21 and 40% wasted meeting investment, your meetings are generally hit or miss. Plenty of time is being wasted. Improvements need to be made, but your scores are sadly typical of what we find in organizations. If your scores are above 41% wasted meeting investment, your meetings need substantial improvement. Your scores are considerably below average. Taken together, the data are clear that meetings are a ubiquitous activity filling calendars and days. We can easily argue that meetings are accounting for years of time in one's professional work life. In considering typical evaluations of meeting quality and the return on meeting investment, we should be highly motivated to solve the problems with meetings. In the next chapter, we queue up a path forward. Takeaways. 1. The amount of time we are spending in meetings is increasing, especially when we look at those involving upper management. Although the statistics vary, it is important to realize that meetings take up an increasingly large amount of time in employees' days. 2. The amount of time spent in meetings translates into big money for today's companies. At the societal level, one estimate comes in at a cost of $1.4 trillion. These costs are underestimates, as they do not include opportunity costs and employee frustration. 3. Although there is evidence to suggest that meetings are a waste of time and are negative experiences for employees, there are also data to suggest that meetings can be productive and meaningful. This provides hope that we can truly solve the meeting problem. 4. Take the time to do the meeting quality self-assessment provided at the end of the book to assess your meeting's return on investment. It's important to do this self-assessment from time to time to ensure that your meetings are positive and productive, and encourage your coworkers to do the same. Remember, your organization has a meeting culture that reflects how everyone runs meetings. Chapter 2. Get rid of meetings? No. Solve meetings through science. A roast is an event where a particular person is subjected to an avalanche of jokes at his or her expense to entertain the broader audience. Let's imagine for a moment that the particular person roasted is not a person, but instead a thing. Meetings. It would not be difficult to roast the concept of meetings, leveraging quotes from journalists or authors, for example, George Will, economists, for example, John Kenneth Galbraith, and a host of anonymous sources, the routine might sound something like this. If you had to identify in one word the reason why the human race has not achieved and never will achieve its full potential, that word would be meetings. A meeting is an event where minutes are taken and hours wasted. We will continue having meetings until we find out why no work is getting done. If I die, I hope it's during a staff meeting, because the transition to death would be so subtle. I'm pretty sure the dinosaurs died out when they stopped gathering food and started having meetings to discuss gathering food. Meetings are indispensable when you don't want to do anything. Our meetings are held to discuss many problems that would never arise if we held fewer meetings. Football incorporates the two worst elements of American society: violence, punctuated by committee meetings. Would eliminating meetings make the world a better place? Was the great management guru, Peter Drucker, correct when he said, "Meetings are a symptom of bad organization. The fewer meetings, the better"? The answer is an emphatic no. The solution is not to dramatically reduce or eliminate meetings, although occasionally reducing meetings is reasonable and appropriate when there is no compelling purpose to meet. Abolishing meetings is a false solution. Schedules with too few meetings are associated with substantial risks for employees, leaders, teams, and organizations. In this chapter, we will look at the evidence for why it is inadvisable to stamp out meetings. Following this, I will try to convince you that the genuine solution to excessive bad meetings is applying the science of meetings to fix them. We need to meet, and we need to meet critical needs. Not holding enough meaningful meetings will likely derail employees, leaders, teams, and organizations. Holding too few meetings robs employees of essential information and feelings of inclusion, support, voice, and community. Meetings help employees build attachments to others and recognize that they are not alone in silos, but instead are part of something bigger than themselves. Meetings make it possible for individual attendees to connect in a highly human way, serving to build relationships, networks, and most important, support. Meetings serve as vehicles to efficiently bring together ideas, thoughts, and opinions, and should enable each person to perform his or her job in a better, more coordinated, and cooperative way. Meetings help both leaders and employees to better make sense of organizational life, challenges, ambiguities, and opportunities, to create a shared understanding that promotes efficiency and teamwork. Meetings foster commitment to goals and initiatives that connect jobs, as well as commitment to broader departmental and organizational aspirations.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.